class, the first Sunday when North Reading kids are out of school. Parents, where are you? It's on the first list. Beginning of summer vacation. And today also a very special day for the church because of a call to church conference, an all-church meeting. All in the church are invited to attend after church and adopt the new list of leadership for the next year, and also talk about the plans and financing for our kitchen. So that is after worship today. I've gotten your prayer requests throughout the week and on the sign-up sheets at the back of the room, so thank you for sharing those with me. And let us then, organizing myself, be in an attitude of prayer. Lord God, thank you for what feels like the beginning of a new season, not just because the calendar tells us that it's actually summer, but that school is out and the weather is warm and the sun is shining. God, we look at this season that stretches out ahead of us and ask that you would add your blessing to it for us, that you would allow us to enter into summertime thinking about vacation and recreation, recreation. God, that you would allow us to use this special time that you've given us well and to bring you glory. Thank you for each person that you've brought to worship today, God, for the faith that you've given to each one of us. And as we come into this worship space today, we want to come with a clean heart, God. And so if there are things that are burdening us, God, a conflict, a difficulty, a sin, something that we have done that's harmed ourselves or others, you, or this beautiful creation, we ask that you would help us to be honest with ourselves about those things and be honest with you, so that we can invite the Holy Spirit into that place and help to heal us and make us better. God, we lay down the sins that we have at your feet, knowing that you took them to the cross, and that because of your resurrection, you have triumphed not only over death, but over sin in this life as well. Thank you, God, for your forgiveness and for your salvation. That spirit of gratitude that is enabled by the eyes of faith. You've heard our prayers. Now we ask that you would hear us as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I just wanted to share the song with you guys. Might be talking a little bit later about putting a choir together and singing this in a couple months, if you maybe are interested. But I just wanted to sing it. It meant a lot to me a couple weeks ago, just listening in my car. It's one of my favorites. It's called Total Praise by Michael W. Smith.
Lift my eyes to thy hills.
But I think we're going to show it this summer, it could still be fun.
I know!
So because it is summertime, that means that we are going to spend a whole summer reviewing the mystery box for the children tomorrow. And then what the mystery box is that it's a box that someone gets to take home with them if they are coming to church the next week also. And you get to look throughout your whole house and pick some mystery item, put it in the box. It's in there, and I don't know what it is. And so I'm going to open the box during the children's moment, and I'm going to think of something that it reminds me of, either a Bible story or something about our faith. And so I asked Eva and Lucy to do the very first mystery box today, and then we'll give it to another family for the next week. And by the way, next Sunday we're going to be as a congregational church. We're not going to be here. We're together with them. This is 4th of July weekend. So when I talk about next week, it's July 9th. July 9th. Parents, if you want to pull up your calendars and see about July 9th. Yes. Who's that? Who will?
I'll be here.
You will not? Okay, so Hannah will not do this. Aww. We should have given it to you.
I'll be back in July 9th.
Okay. Oh my goodness. Oh, this is kind of a hard one, Eva. She's introducing theological controversy, isn't she? It is a dinosaur. But also, there is a loaf and a fish in here, but I think I'm not going to take the easy way out, because a loaf and a fish are more happy. And you're going to make sure to put these back in the nursery where they belong, right when you're done. Yes, do you have something about a dinosaur, Calvin? What? Oh my goodness. I love that. The dinosaurs, like this type, this is a T-Rex, is very, very strong. And that reminds us that God is strong, that God builds up our strength. That's right. I like it. We're going to go with that. Calvin, our little theologian. Congratulations. So thank you for reminding us about how strong God can be. Because dinosaurs are also very strong, and God certainly can be the dinosaur.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm going to put this. Well, no. You're going to put these things back in the nursery where they belong. Who would like the mystery box? Any of you, right? You want to pick. Okay, you pick, and then we'll see if the parents say they're going to be here. Gigi, are you all going to be here? No, they're not going to be here. Glad I'm trying again.
Thank you.
God, thank you for our children, thank you for the joy they bring us, bless them and protect them. And we pray also for the people who will receive the food that we are donating to the food pantry. In Jesus' name, amen. And then they would say, amen! Yay! Okay, perfect. All right. Thank you for your support of that food pantry collection effort. June has been our special month as a church to collect, and it's been impressive if you all. Our psalm this morning comes from the first 10 verses of Psalm 86. Let's read it together. Hear me, Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Guard my life, for I am faithful to you. Save your servant who trusts in you. You are my God. Have mercy on me, Lord, for I call to you all day long. Bring joy to your servant, Lord, for I put my trust in you. You, Lord, are forgiving and good, abounding in love to all who call to you. Hear my prayer, Lord. Listen to my cry for mercy. When I am in distress, I call to you because you answer me. Among the gods, there is none like you, Lord. No deity can compare with yours. All the nations you have made will come and worship before you, Lord. They will bring glory to your name. For you are great and do marvelous deeds. You alone are God.
Now please hear the scripture lesson. The book of 2 Corinthians.
Today's reading from 2 book of Corinthians, chapter 5, verses 17 through 21. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone, the new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them, and he was committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. This is the word of God.
Please pray with me. Lord God, we are so privileged to have this time together, this place, and these people, these brothers and sisters in Christ. We're privileged to have your presence with us through the Holy Spirit. We ask that we would be good stewards of this time, that we would hear the scriptures, that we would open our hearts and minds to the way that you are moving in us each specifically. We ask that you would help me to think and to speak clearly. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So certainly the kids are really excited that school is out. And I have to admit that, at least for me personally, I'm getting to be a little bit more content with the idea of summer vacation now that my children aren't so terribly small. When they're little, it's really, really hard to have that break. As they get a little older, moms and dads of older kids, you start to be able to enjoy this time a little bit more, so not quite as daunting. What is daunting, though, is the amount of stuff that comes home from the school in the last week or so of class. The teachers realize that they have to clean out their classrooms, and so they start sending bags after bags and stacks of paperwork and all this precious artwork that your children have done. And certainly, my first impression is, oh my gosh, too much paper recycled, gosh! But this is your kid's beautiful, precious thing, and so you have to go through slowly and appreciate what they have done. And so this means at the Fisher household, our dining room table is like 6 inches deep in paperwork. I'm trying to keep things ordered. Here's Wesley's stuff and Lucy's stuff. It's just everywhere. And the stuff keeps coming and coming and coming. The last day of school, Eva comes home with a gallon-sized Ziploc bag, two-thirds full of crayons and markers and colored pencils and glue sticks. And I say, Eva, where did all this come from? Like, this isn't just your own supply here, because we didn't send this much in. Where did it come from? She said, my teacher needs the whole classroom to be cleaned out. And so she's sending absolutely everything. So congratulations, teacher, on your clean classroom, because now my house is a disaster, right? That's what it's like. So all this stuff comes completely clean out those backpacks, to absolutely just turn them upside down on that same dining table and let all of the stuff fall out. You know, during the year, you kind of try to stay on top of it, but this thing has started to be like an archaeological dig, you know? Like, here's the permission slip from March 1st, and here's a thing for the sale of the fundraiser in November, and it's all coming out, right? And finally, it's empty. Even the half-broken pencils and caps and paper clips and scraps of what, who knows what, lunch, probably. You can even put that backpack in the washing machine. And it would be like completely clean, totally clean slate, ready now for you to start again next year, just putting in the basic things that you need instead of the accumulation of all this crud over the years. It feels really good to be able to clean something out thoroughly. I know that when I'm troubled in spirit, that's what I like to do, is clean something. Is anybody with me? Does anybody get that way? Like, I'm feeling antsy now, I'm cleaning my stove. Right? Yeah, I'm gonna clean out my junk drawer. It feels really good. There's something, it's almost like there's a connection, you know, a spiritual connection. You can see cleanliness in order that your brain relaxes a little bit. So cleaning out the backpacks is kind of like that. And if it's been a long time since you've had kids at home, you certainly know what I'm talking about. When you clean out your purse, it's the very same principle, ladies. Or guys, maybe, or ladies, maybe you've done a big project at home, like painting the walls of a room, or even reflooring a room, and you have to take everything out and put everything back in. So nice to have that clean, clear space to start fresh from. So we do this in a lot of concrete, tangible ways, like backpacks and purses and maybe spaces in our homes. Occasionally we get to that clean slate place. But do we do this spiritually? Do we ever take time to do this in our relationship with God? To kind of say, all right, I'm going to sort of dump everything out here and take a look and see what I need and what's most important, and then put those things back in. We're at the beginning of vacation season, a season that is dedicated to hopefully some vacation, some recreation, time to get away, change up the pace a little bit. This idea of vacation or recreation, recreation, in spiritual terms, can make us think about what it is to be created in the first place. So I want to go through the story of creation just as an overview. And I learned some things about the creation story this time, so I'm so excited to tell you. And then apply that into our life as people of faith. So, okay, pop quiz. All of you should get this right. How many days in creation?
Seven.
And how many days was God working during those 7 days?
Six.
Okay. And what I learned is that the days of creation are actually double threes. Isn't that nice for you numerology people? It's double threes stacked up on top of each other. And seven, the day of rest. Right? Okay? And this is how it works. In Genesis 1, the first thing that God says is, let there be
light.
So smart. What a smart joke. Let there be light. Okay, the very first sort of domain, our first category that God gives us is light. And then the second thing, this is a little bit more challenging. Does anyone remember? Interesting. It is creating the sky as opposed to the sea. Now the people who are writing this beautiful poetry about the creation of the world didn't know that the world was a ball, thought the world was flat. And what they understood was that water came up from the ground and water also fell from the sky. So their cosmology, the way that they thought about the universe, is that we exist in sort of a bubble, like an upside down bowl, a sky in between the waters in the heavens and the waters under the earth. Does that make sense? That's how they understood the world. So the second day of creation is that God sort of creates this bowl, this space where there's sky and the water up here and the water down there. Okay, so day one, light, two, sky, sea, three, land separated from water. So we have these three separate areas, one, two, three, light, sky, and land and sea. Now, in this, days four, five, and six, the second group of three, we're going to talk about what inhabits each of those spaces, going in the same order. So what inhabits the light? What is the light going to be like? It's going to be the sun and the moon. That's day four. What inhabits the skies and the seas? It's going to be the birds of the sky and the fish of the sea, right? That's day five. And what inhabits the land to the animals and people. Isn't that neat? Did you know about that structure? I didn't. This is why I married Sam. Because Sam tells me. Because he remembers what he said in the seminary. I know. So cool. So we have the spheres. We have the three spheres, and then what populates those three spheres. And then the day of rest. Okay, good. We just heard John read something about creation, but it wasn't about the creation of the universe. It was about us as people being new creations in Christ. That when we come to a relationship with God through Jesus, we are made new. That God kind of takes us really junky backpacks and dumps us out right on the table. And it's like, let's recreate this human being with the fundamental spheres in their place, with the fundamental priorities in place, and then some details about those priorities. So if we are thinking about recreation this summer, or recreation in a spiritual sense, we have an opportunity. Now, even if you're not traveling, some of us can't afford to travel much this summer, or some of us don't have the health to travel this summer. Or if you are, you're going to find yourself somewhere in the blessed space of just sitting there, right? You're going to be on an Adirondack chair. You're going to be on the beach. You're going to be in a hammock, and you're just going to be sitting there. How about an amen? Amen. Just sitting there. And the biggest plan that you have for the day is, what are you going to eat? That is it for that whole day. This is your opportunity, not to give you an assignment or a task, but to look at this as a privilege and an opportunity to say, if I am a new creation in Christ, what are my fundamentals? What are the bare, basic elements of my life, and how are they populated? Do I have a whole bunch of junk piled up in my spiritual backpack, in my purse, in my room? Or do I have those fundamentals in pretty good shape, right? This is what you can do when you're just laying there. You can fall asleep during that and wake back up. Maybe you can even keep a little bit of a notebook, a little bit of a diary about it. What are the fundamentals? Okay, days 1, 2, and 3 of creation. First fundamental, light, is going to be God loves me. There is a God who loves me, right? That is the most fundamental thing about our existence. You may think other things are important. You may think your spouse is important and your job is important. Everything can be taken from you. Everything can be taken from you. Except that you are loved by God. That is the only thing that always stays with you. You hear me? Because we forget and we think, oh yeah, God, oh yeah, that's how I should pray, you know? And sometimes it seems so distant and far away. Everything, this room, your health, your life, your spouse, your family, your job, your talents, everything can go, except that you are loved by God. That is life. Number 2, you are in relationships with people, right? God's given you a family and a spouse and friends, human relationships. 1, relationship with God. 2, relationship with humans. And 3, talents, abilities, things that God has given you that you're good at. Right? These are the 3 most basic aspects of your life. And so you can say, when you're laying in the hammock, iced tea glass, sweating, I smell things, maybe I should be filling my iced tea. Back to sleep, right? That's good. That's good. Take that resting time. But out of those 3 elements, what populates those elements? Or what is the detail on those elements in my life? If I am aware as a person of faith that God loves me, how do I support that in my life? How do I encourage that? What do I do as a person who's created and loved by God to build that relationship? Do I pray regularly? Do I create time to be in worship as much as I'm able to be? Right? Do I work and build and strengthen that relationship with God as much as I can? Do I attend to it? That's sphere 1. Sphere 2, relationships with other people. Now this is where the 2 Corinthians reading comes into play. Because Paul is saying in 2 Corinthians, you are a new creation in Christ. You are now an ambassador for Christ. Because God has made friends with you, now it's your privilege to be able to show other people that they can also be friends with God, that they can have a relationship with God. So when we think about our relationship with others, it's going to relate to that development of the relationship with God. Are we around people who encourage our spiritual life, who encourage our faith life, who strengthen it, who are a positive influence? Are there people that are detrimental to that and try to pull us away from God and bring us into behaviors and activities and habits that aren't glorifying to God? Think about those personal relationships and how they impact your relationship. And for the people who are, this is a pastor euphemism, the people who are ministry people, right? The people who take work in your life. Okay, yeah, there's some people who take extra work. Can you be an influence? Can you be an ambassador? Can you be somebody who says, God is your friend? Are you able to do that and see hopefully some success with it, some seeds have been planted? So in that second realm of human relationships, how do they feed you and your relationship with God, and how can you help bless them and encourage their relationship with God? Final category, talents, your talents. I hope that the things that you love to do and feel like that you are good at doing are the things that also give you your income. I hope so. Not always true, is it? But I hope that when you go to work, if you are working, that you are using the gifts that God has given you and it brings you some joy. Number one, so our talents are good for that, but our talents are also made to be used in service to God in this world. Aren't they? And I really would be so upset right now if anybody in this room thought that the only talents that were good for serving God are preaching and playing the piano and singing. You get a big F if you think that that's all you can do to serve God. Absolutely not true. God can use every single dominant gift that you have in this whole church, in this church. Do you believe it? Because you're thinking, well, I'm really good at Excel, Rachel. Computer spreadsheets, right? How am I going to use it? Ask Sam. He's used Excel to bless the church, right? Every gift that has been given to this population of people, this congregation, can be used so that this church can be built up, so that the witness of God can be built up. I hope that the church is a creative and flexible place that's able to say, wow, you're really good at painting? Let's paint. Actually, I know this church is really good at that particular part. Right, but the gifts that you have. So when you're thinking about that third sphere of your talents, be thankful to God. Thank you for letting me earn a living. Use that talent. But also, God, how are you calling me to serve with this gift? What can I do to show people that you love them with this gift, either inside the church or somewhere outside the church? That's the way to think about that third realm. So your relationship with God, your relationship with people, and the talents that you have been given, the three spheres, and how they are filled out, how they made more specific. You got it? If you have like a chart in your head now, day seven. Rest. So important. So important. Could it just end with six, right? Why doesn't it just end with six? Except there's seven there to tell us that we get that time of refreshment and renewal and recreation, recreation. One of the things that Sam and I hope to be able to do this summer, probably, hopefully, is to put down ourselves. We plan on doing the work ourselves, some hardwood floor up in the kids' bedrooms. We have carpet up there now, and my kids have been sick one too many times. That's all I'm going to say when I'm preaching. You get my drift, moms. I was like, I'm never cleaning this off the animal carpet again. This is awful. We need to put down wood. So I think we're going to do that, and I'm really looking forward to it as an opportunity. So we get to pull up our kids' rooms. Just yesterday, I was like, please clean up. There is just Kleenex and hair bands and things everywhere. Trying to get them to sort of maintain and just do the superficial stuff is one thing, but the thought of getting everything out of one of those rooms so that we can refloor it, and then just introducing the basics, the bed, the dressers, the nightlight, absolutely essential, nightlight, things like that. What an opportunity that is. What a gift that is. To clear it out and put the basics back in. I hope that during this season of vacation and recreation, that you're going to find yourself on that day seven moment, that still moment, where you can think about the fundamentals of your life spiritually and the things that fill them up. Amen. Amen. are quite aware of many good gifts that you give us. We know that everything has come from you, and so we ask that you would receive this part of what you have given us. You would receive it back so that it can be used for your service in this world. We ask that you bless it and multiply it, help this church to be a good steward of the resources you have given. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
So Jeff, if you want to come up front.
If your child is participating in the Vacation Bible School program, we have a music CD of all the music that they are covering during the summer. There are two, I think, still left on the back table, so please take one and stick it in your car or in your house and have the kids listen to that. Also, last Sunday, there was a special announcement from a man, a North Reading resident, who is helping on the Justice for Our Neighbors Street Food Fair. That's happening today in Woburn at the Lutheran Church of the Redeemer, fundraising for funds for legal counsel for immigrants. And that's an interfaith opportunity. That's a Lutheran church. He comes from a Lutheran church. They're working with the Methodist Church in Woburn. So that is this afternoon, and there is a flyer up on the bulletin board at the back of the room. I think it's like $30 a person, and that goes for that legal fee. You get to taste all this cool international food at the street fair. So keep that in mind. Go ahead, Jeff.
So today, as Rachel mentioned, is Charge Conference. Anyhow, there's been a lot of folks in this church that have done a lot of hard work on coming up with a direction for the future of the kitchen in the church. As everybody knows, that serves a lot of what we do, a lot of our outreach programs. And anyhow, the team is going to put their recommendations to the conference today. And we encourage everyone to be there to participate in the decision making. This is an important decision that is going to shape the direction of the church for a number of years. So we really want to encourage everyone to participate, and we're looking for all opinions and input into this decision. And anyhow, welcome everybody to come and participate in this decision making process. It's going to be 11:45 right at the church. So please come and join us, hear what the team's got to say, and help us make the right decision for the church.
For United Methodist nerds out there, the difference between a charge conference and a church conference is that at a charge conference, only members can vote. After discussing with our district superintendent this process and our church, he said, have it be a church conference. That means that everyone in attendance can vote, not just people who've been accepted as members. So that's why it was a church conference, as determined by our district superintendent. Okay. Yes, I see you, Noah. What would you like to say? Contact business owners with whom we have a relationship I find it a very easy ask, and at least what you're doing is saying our church is giving a free breakfast, and that is a win right there. So there are some sheets at the back of the sanctuary. They will be there for a number of weeks. You can take them, and they are a registration form with a picture of what the placemat looks like so that businesses can decide if they want to join us. We do that during the summer. The deadline is August 31st so that the new one can be printed. So thank you for your help on that. People going on the main mission trip, we are leaving in 2 weeks from today. Your campground fee and your grocery money needs to be turned in by next Sunday. Next Sunday, we're worshiping at Union Congregational Church, 10 a.m. We will not be here, but we can take money that comes in that day still and make a deposit. We need to have it before we go so that the church can write the check to the campground before we go. And on the same note, there is a GoFundMe, fundraising materials cost. We have a $2,500 materials cost, and as of this morning, we have a little over $800, I think, raised of the $2,500, which means that especially the main mission team members need to share that with friends. I took that, just the link to it, and sent it to about five people that I know love me and have been hearing about Maine for years, and I just said, can you help? And God gives them three of them already, and so just do that. Just do that. It's going to help, and we want to get to $2,500 in fundraising. Again, I mentioned that next Sunday is at Union Congregational Church, 10 a.m., and that will be the beginning of 10 o'clock worship for the rest of the summer. This church will worship at 10 o'clock on July 9th. That will be the next time that we are together. Okay, those are all of my announcements. For celebration and thanks, we are celebrating Heather Morissette for her efforts of painting in the education wing. Give Heather a hand. Welcome you, anyone who's interested, to stay for the meeting starting at 11:45. In addition to the kitchen votes, which is on plans and on financing, we are adopting a new slate of leaders for this next year. Please stand for the benediction. May the God who has created us out of the dust into a beautiful new creation in Christ be with us until we meet again. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.